Hello everyone, I welcome you all on this session on the topic superconductivity. This topic superconductivity we are going to discuss in next 1 hour or so. So this time limit and this everything will not permit us to go into the theoretical discussions, and we may not cover all the aspects. But I will definitely try to let you understand the basics and the interest about superconductivity I will try to create through this session. So as I understand, the students or the participants who are attending this session, they are right from the first year to the final year of their graduation. So we will try to go from the basics to the advanced applications, and everything we will try to understand, and I will definitely try to let you explore the concept of superconductivity and various dimensions attached to it. But there would be some points which we will not go into the complete details. Okay. So anyway, let us start this discussion. So the contents of this today's topic would be: what is the superconductivity, then how it is, what makes something a superconductor, and how it works, that we are going to discuss. Then the next thing that we are going to see is where to use this concept. So there are various technological applications this superconductivity have, and now more than 100 years we know something like superconductivity. So we have used it in the various applications. Okay, so at the beginning, let us start with one or two jokes kind of a thing that will bring smile to our face, because generally we think there is some stigma attached to physics kind of a thing, that it is difficult, it is not interesting. So let us make some use first 2-3 minutes for some fun. Okay, so what this cartoon, this image is saying is, physics would have been much easier if a tree had fallen on the Newton's head instead of the apple. So instead of apple, if the tree would have fallen on the Newton's head, so we should not but in the funny way we can say it. So that says ki then the theory wouldn't be developed by Newton, and rest is history. Okay, so this symbol we know. This is the symbol for unit of resistance, ohm, and what these all the ohms they are meditating, and one of the ohm is saying to the resistance that come meditate with me, you don't have to resist everything. Okay, so we must have that mindset while learning these fundamental courses, that we don't have any resistance towards them, and we absorb them, we think over them, and we keep meditating, and we keep analyzing the things at our mind, and that will definitely help us. Okay, so whatever we are going to discuss in next 1 hour or so, so you also try to absorb it, you try to learn it, you try to listen it carefully, and don't have any resistance towards the things that are being shared with you. Okay, so with this, let us start the actual discussion. So whenever we have a current carrying conductor, so let us say copper wire we have, and it is connected to a power supply, or as this image is showing the bulb, and we put the bulb into the holder and we pass the current through it by applying some voltage. So what happens is when the electrons, they flow through this thin tungsten wire, what happens is there this tungsten wire, there would be light glowing. Okay, so what is happening here is this electron, it is colliding with the ions. So this red dot, I have shown it as an electron, and these blue dots, they are the ions. So these electron will keep colliding with these ions, and electron they would be repelling each other, and there would be scattering, there would be repelling the electrons, and the black line kind of a path, the zigzag path, electrons would be moving through the current carrying conductor. Okay, so current passing through the wire would be something like this. So eventually that therefore there would be some resistance. Okay, so what causes resistance in the materials which to the electrons flow? Temperature would have a role to play, thermal agitations would have a role to play, of course scattering will have the role in the resistance. Okay, so whenever in normal specific situation, the temperature, thermal agitations and scattering would contribute positively to the resistance of the substance. Okay, so this is the background that we are creating to understand the concept of superconductivity. So here with these two images, of course we have this animation also from the actual site. I will try to show you. So let us say that we have this iron wire, and this iron wire is connected to this 1.5 volt two batteries. So the total voltage is 3 volts, and this iron wire, you can see it is moving, it is connected to this bulb, and it is going from here, and it is wounded over this ceramic spool, and it is again going to the negative of the battery. And something interesting we have done here, that we have put a burner below this ceramic spool. So what we are going to do is, suppose we click on this turn on button, then this Bunsen burner will be burning. Okay, so as soon as we switch on this burner, what has happened is the burner has started burning, and the flame, it is reaching to this iron wire, and because of that, what has happened is resistance in this wire has increased. So resistance is increased due to the heat and rise in temperature through the iron wire, and therefore what has happened is, therefore the flow of electron is got hampered, the resistance in this wire is increased, and therefore the bulb is not glowing. Okay, so let me switch over and let me show you this through the actual this thing. So if you see here, what is happening is, this is the same image that we have seen. So whenever I turn on the burner, there you can see the flame has appeared and the bulb is now not glowing. Okay, so let me turn off it. So as soon as the burner is switched off, the electron flow is proper in good amount, and therefore the bulb is glowing. So this is the effect that this has on the resistance through the wire. Okay, so this is what we have understood, that thermal agitations, scattering and temperature, they play an important role in the flow of electrons. Okay, so at the beginning of this 19th century, somewhere in 1913, the scientist Kamerling Onnes, he was interested in studying the elements at very low temperature, and what happens to the helium when it is cooled to a very low temperature. So he was trying to have a device which will cool the this helium gas at a very low temperature. So while this study, one interesting observation he made, that is, the study of the metals or resistance at a very low temperature. So he was having mercury. So in mercury, while he was trying to note down the resistance of the substance, what has happened is, as you can see in this graph, with the temperature decreasing in this direction, the resistance is dropping. This drop is slow, but something very interesting has happened at this point, and you can see it is nearly dropping very steep slope, and it has reduced to zero. Okay, so to say what is superconductivity, what we will say is, the electrical resistance fall to zero at very low temperature, vanishing of electrical resistance would be called as superconductivity. So what we need to understand about superconductivity is, superconductivity is the electrical resistance reduces to zero. That means there is no resistance to the electrons. Electrons will move through it without any resistance. So this kind of behavior is called as superconductivity. But one thing is to be remembered, where does it happen? It happens at very low temperature. So what do we mean by this is, as soon as you have the temperature below a certain temperature, then the substance will become superconductor, and as soon as you increase the temperature again, it goes to the normal temperature. So that temperature we will call it as critical temperature. So below the critical temperature, the substance remains into the superconducting state. As soon as your temperature is higher than that temperature, then it will be in the normal state. So there would be some resistance offered to the electrons. Okay. So this phenomenon was a very new thing that was observed by the scientist Kamerling only. Okay. So to put it in a proper words and to understand it as this definition. So the phenomenon of sudden disappearance of electrical resistivity in materials when cooled to sufficiently low temperature is called as superconductivity. So always it was believed ki in a standard way what should happen is this temperature versus electrical resistance would be a inclined line, something like 45 degrees line like this. And passing through the origin, that is zero. So at zero Kelvin there won't be any resistance. But what was assumed is though the temperature is zero Kelvin, but there would be certain resistance due to scattering and electron-electron repulsion, there would be some resistance. So therefore what was predicted is for normal metals the curve would be something like this. So they will be having certain resistance even at zero Kelvin. But when this was studied experimentally for the elements like mercury, so what they observed is this, though the resistance was decreasing at certain temperature, the resistance suddenly dropped to zero. So therefore this temperature would be called as a critical temperature. So the materials that exhibit this superconductivity, they are called as superconductors. Okay. So some substance would be called as a superconductor, but it would show the superconductivity below the critical temperature. Above the critical temperature, it will be having all the properties of the normal substance. Okay, so there will be some electrical resistance above critical temperature, but as soon as the material goes to the temperature below critical temperature, then the substance will have no resistance to the flow of electrons. Okay, so out of these elements in the periodic table, nearly half of the elements they show good superconductivity, and of course there are various combinations like now suppose materials are in the nano stage, something will happen if their compounds, their alloys and their different combinations. So there are n number of such kind of things. But these superconducting materials, the most of the elements in the periodic table, nearly more than half of them, they show the superconducting behavior. Okay. So from this graph, let us try to understand this. So what do we mean by this is the temperature is on x-axis, okay, here, and the resistance is on y-axis. So this dotted line. So below this dotted line, the material would remain in the superconducting state, and above this material will turn out into the normal state. Okay. So in this range, the substance would be superconducting, while in this range, the material would be normal temperature. And for superconductors, what happens is that though the resistance keep decreasing, but at critical temperature, the resistance suddenly drops to zero. So there are many elements and many alloys they exhibit superconducting behavior. Okay. So this is what we have seen about the temperature. So when the temperature is below a certain temperature, then there would be existence of superconductivity. But what about magnetic field? So people have studied that, and what they did is they tried to apply the magnetic field on the superconductors. So what are the choices we have? Either what you do is you have a superconductor, let it be in superconducting state. That means the temperature around that substance is below critical temperature and the substance is in critical, so the substance is in superconducting state. Now you apply magnetic field on it. So if you apply a weak magnetic field, then what has happened is that magnetic field was not allowed to pass through the substance. Okay. So the substance would remain in the superconducting state. Okay. When we put a superconductor in a magnetic field, an electric current flows through its surface. Okay. So this current create a magnetic field that is exactly cancels the original magnetic field. That magnetic field is trying to get inside the superconductor. So that will be repelling the magnetic field outside. So this is known as Meissner effect. So this explains how can you make a superconductor levitate on a magnetic field. So this thing we are going to discuss in a greater detail in the one of the application of magnetic levitation train, maglev. So what is basically happening is, if you have a superconductor and if it is in superconducting state, so then if you put it in a magnetic field, then what happens is the electric current flows around the superconductor substance, and that current do not allow the magnetic field to pass through the substance. So what exactly to be remembered is, superconductor in a superconducting state behaves exactly like a diamagnetic material. So magnetic field of lines will be repelled out of the substance. So superconductors, they are diamagnetic materials. Okay. So let us see here. What we have seen here is, suppose these lines, these red lines, they are magnetic field of lines, and this circle here, this is the superconducting substance. So and the temperature is much above the critical temperature, so that means the substance is right now is not in the superconducting state. So as the substance is not in the superconducting state, this magnetic field of lines could pass through it. Okay. But as soon as we have this temperature below the critical temperature, then these magnetic field of lines are thrown out of the substance, or they are just like repelled out of the substance. Okay. So this effect is primarily known as Meissner effect. So in this theory kind of a thing, it is appearing a bit boring or bit not that much concern to us, but when we will see an example, then this will make you have some interest in it. So let us see that this is the superconductor we have. Okay, so this black material is a superconductor, and this is the container in which the superconductor is kept. And earlier, due to its weight and gravity, this magnet was exactly sitting on the surface of the superconductor. But then what we have done is, we have poured the liquid helium into this container, and because of that, the temperature surrounding to the superconductor has reduced. And as soon as the temperature is reduced below the critical temperature of the superconductor, then what has happened is, the substance has become superconducting state. So it has gone into the superconducting state. So as soon as it went into the superconducting state, so this magnet was trying to pass the magnetic field through the superconductor, and it expelled. There was a current, there would be a current flowing through around this magnet, and because of that current, there would be a repulsion between this superconducting substance and this magnet, and that magnet will be levitating in the air against gravity. So here there is an air gap, and that magnet is just hanging in the air. So if you see, suppose we have two magnets, and both are having their same poles facing each other. Suppose north is facing to north, then what will happen is, if you hold them carefully, then you can hold the upper magnet into the air against gravity, and it will be hanging in the air, and there would be gap between them. So that kind of a situation has occurred due to this effect. That effect is called as Meissner effect. So the thing to remember here is, these superconductors, they are diamagnetic material in the superconducting state, and they won't allow the magnetic field of lines to pass through them. Okay. So how many Nobel Prizes are given in the field of for the research in the superconductivity? There are five Nobel Prizes being given. It was given for the discovery of the phenomenon. It was awarded in 1913. So it was given to Hike, Kamerling, Onnes. Okay. So there onwards, nearly 60 years, we were not knowing what is the theory behind this superconductivity phenomenon. So we knew the phenomenon that as soon as you reduce the temperature, the electrical resistance would vanish. But we were not knowing the reason or the theory behind it. So in 1972, John Bardeen, Leon Cooper and John Schrieffer, they developed a theory. So that theory was the initials of their surnames. So Bardeen's B, Cooper and Schrieffer, that together it was called as BCS theory. And this BCS theory explained the many observations of the superconductors. So a year later, Isaki, Gevier and Josephson, they developed some new arrangements they did, and they found out some effect. That effect was called as Josephson effect. So we are going to discuss that Josephson effect also in another two or three slides. Okay. So what Josephson effect means is just like we have tunnels to the mountains. So when we want to go to from one side to other side, and there is a mountain in between, so what do we do is we dig a tunnel and we have a road from where we can go. So therefore I put that image of tunnel. So electrons also tunnel through this junction, and that junction is called a. As you have seen, the superconductivity was observed at very low temperature, something like 4.15 and 4.2 Kelvin in case of super, in case of mercury. In case of aluminium, it would be around 7 Kelvin, and similarly it will be around in the range of 4 to 20 to 25 Kelvin. So to have them in the operating range where we can work with them, so we needed to have them at least in the liquid nitrogen temperature. So that major breakthrough came with the work of Jonas Bendros and Karl Müller, when they discovered something that is called as high temperature superconductors. So this oxides cuprate material, oxygen and copper layers were present into these superconducting materials, and they could exhibit the superconductivity at around 130 to 140 Kelvin. So if you see it on a normal scale, still it is nearly 130-140 degree Celsius, -130 -140 degree Celsius. So it is still very low temperature, but it is much feasible, much easier, and quite easily achievable temperature with liquid nitrogen rather than working with liquid helium. Okay. So that was a major breakthrough that occurred. And then in 2003, one new observation was made about being type 2 superconductors. So there onwards, it was now it is known to us that there are two types of superconductors. One of them is called as type 1 superconductor, while the other one is called as type 2 superconductors. Okay, so the credit for this was given to Abrikosov, Ginsburg and Liggett. And they did this work and they got the Nobel Prize in 2003. So this is the total five Nobel Prizes given in the field of superconductivity. And still we never know, we get room temperature superconductivity, and we may get some new dimension to it, and somebody will get Nobel Prizes for the superconductivity further research. Okay. So this is the image of the pioneer of the field, that is Hake Ohms. He was trying to liquefy the helium. So we know, just take an example of ice, water and vapor. So vapor condenses and becomes water. Water then becomes, water is cooled down, it becomes ice. If ice melts water, and water again heated, it becomes vapor. So whether is it true for the helium and these other substances and for this? So he was trying to liquefy the helium, and this is the instrument that he has indigenously developed. And the other scientist who is seen on this image is Van der Waal. So we know the Van der Waal forces. These are the very to be precise, the weakest force in the nature. Okay, so they were having altogether different insight towards looking at the things. And once he got Nobel Prize in 1913 for his investigations on the properties of matter at low temperature, which led to all other different things, but for the production of liquid helium. So this liquid helium is a superfluid. So what do we mean by superfluid is if you hold a glass and water inside, so that water will not come out by itself by creeping at the walls. But if you hold liquid helium, then the liquid helium will creep along the walls of the glass, and the glass will fall down from your hand. So that is the superfluid property this liquid helium have. But this is altogether different story. We will focus on the superconductivity. Okay, so the next thing, that major thing, came in the form of BCS theory. So all the observations about this, many of the observations about the superconductivity were given proper theoretical background by these three scientists, John Bardeen, Leon Cooper and John Schrieffer. So they got this Nobel Prize for developing this BCS theory. And why I have shown this Nobel medals twice here with the Bardeen is, Bardeen is the perhaps the only physicist who got Nobel Prize for the, twice he got Nobel Prize, once for the transistor, discovery of transistor he made in 1950s at AT&T Bell, American Telegraph and Telephone Company. And after discovery of transistor in 1970s, he could develop this theory of the superconductivity. That theory is called as BCS theory. Okay, so the main points of the BCS theory is what they proposed is, instead of electron flowing through the substance, what has happened is electron they make a pair, and this pair, this jodi of the electrons, they move through this substance by mediated by the phonons. So what do we mean by phonon? It is like just a packet of energy, as it is in the form of photon for the light. So this will be a vibration packet or sound energy packet, that is called as phonon. So these electron, one of them loses momentum, one of them gains momentum, and these positive and negative, opposite spin and opposite momentum electrons, they get mediated by the phonons and they keep moving through the lattice without any resistance. But this will happen only at very low temperature. Okay. So I am going to show you an animation from where this will get very clear. Okay, and the other thing is, if Cooper pairs are in a bound state, then how much energy would be required to split and to make them into individual electrons? That experimental measurements and evidence for it, that was also given by this BCS theory. Okay, and the temperature at which superconductivity will appear, it is related to the isotopes of the element, and it reduces if the heavier isotope of the elements are present. So heavier the isotopes, the transition temperature would be lesser for the to achieve the superconductivity. This effect was called as isotope effect, and this isotope effect was also explained in the BCS theory. So the critical temperature is inversely proportional to the mass of the isotope. So here you can see, I have shown the two isotopes of this mercury. One is with the isotope with the mass 200.6, and the other is one with 198 mass. So you can see the transition temperature for 200, it is 4.156, and for lower atomic mass, it is more transition temperature, that is 4.177 Kelvin. So higher the atomic mass, the lower the transition temperature. So there is an inverse proportion between the isotope mass and the transition temperature. So these are the observations and these are the clarifications given in the BCS theory. Okay, so it is like these two yellow these images of the what we call them as these emojis. They are holding their hands and they are moving without any resistance through the structure of the ions. We call it as these lattice. They are moving. And you can see this right side cartoon image, that is a kind of a roller coaster or this this slide. These electrons are sliding very easily through it. So this other image that that is shown here. So this game, this we might have seen on TV, where this ice skating, where the whole floor is made up of ice, and these gentlemen and lady, they have this specific these shoes, and they show their dancing and these moving skills. As there is very less resistance, they can keep moving on this ice floor. Okay. So at this moment, let me show you how this Cooper pair works. So let us go here. So what we have seen is this red dots. These are the having positive ions. So these are the ions in the lattice. Okay, and these ions, they are in a normal situation, they would be vibrating and they would be dissipating energy, and they would be coming close to each other and going away from each other. So therefore, the next thing that I am going to show you is not possible. But in a normal situation, sorry, whenever there would be a very low temperature, what would happen is these ions wouldn't have that much of energy to keep vibrating along their about their mean positions. And in that situation, if an electron shown by this circle, it comes, then what happens is these ions would get attracted towards this positive ions, and these positive ions would come close to the electron, and because of this, there would be a positive charge around this electron. So this electron, which has attracted the two positive ions, because of which there would be some positive field created around this electron, and some other electron would get attracted towards it because it won't see, or the negative repulsion wouldn't be there, but the positive charge of these two positive ions coming close to this electron, that has created a positive charge around the electron. So these two electrons, though they are negatively charged, and as they are of opposite spin and opposite momentum, they would remain in a bound state, and that bound state of the two electrons, that will be called as Cooper pair. Of course, those two electrons would remain in a bound state at low temperature, and as soon as you provide enough energy to the ions to vibrate, then this additional binding by the positive charge would not be there, and this superconducting state would be destroyed. Okay, so these two electrons, they are in a bound state, and now they will move through the lattice without any resistance. So they have moving very easily through the lattice. Okay, so let me show you it one more time. So let us see, this is the electron that is coming. These positive ions are attracting it. Because of this, there is a positive charge around the electron. This positive charge attracts another electron. These two electrons are of opposite spin and opposite momentum, and they will remain in a bound state below critical temperature and below critical magnetic field, and they will move through the lattice without any resistance. So this was the theory that was given for the formation of Cooper pair and having superconducting state. Okay, so let us come back to the discussion. Okay, so next observation, that we call it as Josephson effect. So this electrons if you have two superconductors and if you separate them, so you see here, so let us say that this box is one superconductor, this another box is another superconductor, and this is that electron-electron Cooper pair, CWPER Cooper pair we are calling it as. And these two superconductors, they are in superconducting state and they are separated by a non-superconducting barrier. So very thin metal or insulator we have placed in between these two superconductors. So what is the thing that we are going to observe? Okay, so by thin, what do we mean is around 20 to 30 angstrom. So 10 to the power minus 10 meters. So 20 into 10 to the power minus 10 meters, or 30 into 10 to the power minus 10 meters. That much thin non-superconducting layer is present between these two superconductors. So these electron pairs that will penetrate as if it is moving through a ghat and there is a tunnel and the bus is moving. So these electron pairs, they would be tunneling through it. So that kind of effect is called as Josephson effect, and this kind of a junction would be called as Josephson junction. Okay, so a DC current flows across the junction in the absence of electric or magnetic field. So whether you have applied a electric field or magnetic field or not, if you have two superconductors and have them together with a insulating layer in between, so there will be a DC current flowing through it. And the other thing is also an important observation, that if you apply a DC voltage across the junction, then the current disappears and a high frequency radio wave is developed. So if you apply a voltage, it will not result into current, but the current will disappear and you will find a high frequency radio wave is being generated. So what does that conversion will be called as? A voltage converted into a amplitude conversion or a frequency conversion is occurring at this Josephson junction. Okay, so if you don't have an electric field, you will get a DC current. If you apply a DC voltage, then you will get high frequency radio wave is being generated across this insulating barrier. So this kind of effect is called a Josephson junction. Okay, I understand this is becoming a bit more and more complicated. If this is true, that is going to happen. But you keep patience and keep listening to this, because this is you need to read more, and little bit revision would help us. Okay. So the next thing next major thing that has happened is the high temperature superconducting oxide materials. Okay. So as I told you that this superconducting temperatures where superconductivity was possible at 4 Kelvin, 10 Kelvin and very low temperatures. But then this major breakthrough came with the this work of Bedons and Muller, when they found out this high temperature superconducting oxides, and this major step has changed from 10 Kelvin to nearly 138 Kelvin the superconductivity was achieved. So majorly there was a copper and oxygen alternate layers were there, and those materials, they were called as cuprates, and these cuprates, they had they exhibited superconductivity at a considerably high temperature, that is in the range of liquid nitrogen. Okay, so some of the compounds with their transition critical temperatures are like this. So as you can see, all the chemical formulas, they are having copper oxide as one of their important part in the formulas, and the other is you are having mercury, bismuth, yttrium, lanthanum, neodymium. These are the compounds, and their respective critical temperature ranges from 24 Kelvin to 134 Kelvin. So considerably 134 Kelvin, 127 Kelvin, these are high temperature superconductors. Okay, so thereafter one more observation was added into this theory of superconductivity, that is the type 2 superconductors. So what do we mean by type 1 and type 2 superconductors is, as you can see here, so this is the applied magnetic field and this is the response. So as soon as if you keep increasing the magnetic field, then there will be internal magnetic field will be keep increasing, and at a certain value this internal magnetic field will be destroyed, and it will reduce to zero. That magnetic field will be call it we will call it as critical HC. Okay, so so here you can see in this type 2 superconductor, the superconductivity starts decreasing with this here. So superconductivity start lose the substance start losing its superconducting state at this HC1, but ultimately it completely loses superconductivity and returns to normal state at this temperature HC2. So in between HC1 to HC2, in this state it remains in the mixed state. That is, it will have some normal state behavior and it will have some superconducting state behavior. So what we can say is this type 1 superconductors, they are called as soft superconductors because the superconductivity is lost at a very low critical magnetic field. While in the to completely remove the superconductivity in this other class of material, it requires a very high value of magnetic field to destroy the superconducting state. So therefore they are called as hard superconductors. These soft superconductors, they have only one critical magnetic field, and this type 2 superconductors, you can see it has HC1 and HC2 two magnetic fields, where somewhere for HC1 it starts losing superconductivity, at HC2 it completely loses the superconducting state. These type 1 superconductors, they don't have any applications as such, but this type 2 superconductors, they have these the applications. Okay, so these are the main important distinguishing points between type 1 and type 2 superconductors. Okay, so the next target that we have is we need to have room temperature superconductivity. So this room temperature superconductivity was recently reported in an article in Nature by this Snyder, the author name, and there are few co-authors. They reported the room temperature superconductivity in carbonaceous sulfur hydride material. So this carbonaceous sulfur hydride material, the chemical formula is like this, H2S CH4H2. So this hydrogen being very lightweight and carbon being a covalent, carbon having the covalent bondings, so that will help in the this thing of having the Cooper pairs remain in the bound state. But right now it has observed to have transition temperature around 50 degrees Celsius, but it has achieved at a very high pressure. So this high temperature, the high pressure means nearly 267 gigapascal temperature they applied to achieve the room temperature superconductivity. So we cannot say that room temperature superconductivity is not possible. Room temperature superconductivity is now is a published fact, but it has happened at a very high pressure. So what we need is room temperature, room pressure, normal pressure superconductivity, and that is yet remains to be an achieved thing. So what they do is they have one this diamond axial cell kind of a device. So it can sit on our palm of our hand, and it generates extreme pressures something like the at the core of the earth kind of a pressure they will be applying, and that pressure would be applied through the two tips of the diamonds, and it will be applied on a very small area. If you can see here, these are the two diamonds and their tips, and we have sandwiched the substance to which the huge pressure is to be applied, and we know the formula for pressure is force upon area. So very small area is selected, therefore you have a huge pressure applied. So what we have is a substance which is made up of hydrogen, sulfur, carbon, and it is crushed between two diamonds, and it superconducts at room temperature, but the only problem is it requires very high pressure. So at some day we will have room temperature normal pressure superconductors, and that will solve our all the energy related problems. Okay, so now we have seen that electrical resistance reduces, of course it vanishes. There is a role of magnetic field, there is a role of pressure, all these things we have seen, and we have tried to understood something like superconductivity. But for what reason this is to be done? So this is used for various technological applications. One of them is used in medical science for MRI imaging, magnetic resonance imaging device. The other is maglev, that is a magnetic levitation train. So a fast locomotive is available. So in China and in Japan, Korea, they are having these super fast maglev trains. And the other application is superconductors. Okay, so the in 2-3 minutes I will explain you what is the logic of MRI. So what they do is you, if you visit some hospital and if you see the MRI images, they have this very this containers and this metal cylinders would be there of liquid nitrogen. So what is the basic logic is to produce the magnetic field, we need electromagnets. So what is a electromagnet? Electromagnet is a coil around wound around the conductor, and if you pass the current through it, it will produce magnetic field. So if you have two such kind of things, then it will be having a magnetic field present in between that two. But the problem is if you want more and more stronger magnetic field, you need to pass more and more current. If you pass more current, it will produce heat, and to overcome that heat, there would be requirement of again more power. So with these superconductors, you have electrons flowing without any resistance. So basically you are producing electromagnets of superconducting coils, which will produce a very high uniform magnetic field without heat losses and without dissipating energy in the heat. Okay, so with the in the MRI, what they do is they produce a uniform and a strong magnetic field, and as our body contains mostly nearly 70% is water, so it is H2O, so it will have this hydrogen will have a proton, and all these protons they will get aligned into that magnetic field. Okay, and with these all the protons, either they will be in the parallel direction or they will be in the anti-parallel direction, and then they apply a radio frequency signal so that these aligned in one direction protons, they will be pushed into certain other direction, and then they will remove that signal, and they will, these protons, they will get relaxed and they will take some time to return back to their position. Okay, so this time is recorded, and with some other color pigments and this thing, this can be recorded that how much time is taken by the protons. So suppose everywhere in the brain and everywhere, all these substances will have different content of water. And suppose there is somewhere is something has gone wrong and some tumor kind of a thing is present, so it will also have a different amount of water, and that will create a different image. So if you have some pigments and contrasting agents, then this kind of thing could be located, and that is how this scanning technique works in MRI. Okay, so similarly in this maglev train, what happens is the superconducting magnets are fixed to the at the place of tires to the train, and the tracks are also made up of the magnetic material. So this train will be levitated or hanging in the air around 3 to 4 inches in the air, and that will remove the heat resistance and friction loss. All these things would be reduced, and the train would be they are available hanging in the air around 3 to 4 inches. Okay, and alternately this north south kind of a arrangement of the coils that will push or that will attract the train to the next polarity, and the north north they will repel each other, and again it faces, there is south again, so next coil, so it will pull the train. So this is how the levitation and propulsion, both the things are served, and with a very less power you can move the train with a very high speed. So there would be lesser energy required, and there would be of course, because it is now happening at a very low temperature, to maintain that temperature and to install this technology, it would take time and it will require money. But ultimately this kind of thing, because our normal trains, they are moving at around, say, let us say, not more than 60 to 100, 120 kilometers per hour, but these trains would be moving around 400, 450 kilometers per hour. So that would be 500 kilometers, let us say. So that would be very high speed trains would be available. And the third application that I am discussing is this superconductors. So there would be two logic gates, storage of information, and moving the logic gates, the signals from one to second bit, it would take a very high amount of energy. As you keep on increasing the number of memory storage units involved, and the signals to be transferred. So a normal laptop would be doing 1 gigaflops, that is 10 to the power 9. Okay. So what is the full form of flops is floating points operations per second. So but that is the case with the normal laptops. But in case of supercomputers, we need some operations in the exaflops. So what do we mean by exaflops is 10 to the power 18 operations per second. So that is a huge number. Okay. So to match the performance, one calculation every second, we need to do it for nearly this many billion years, and that is a very huge number. Okay. So this kind of operations are possible, these many logic operations are possible only with the superconductors, because they operate at a very low temperature. Okay, because let us say if you wish to do it with the normal CMOS technology, it would take around 500 megawatts power, and that will again result into heat, and that is not going to be a sustainable thing. So that is how we are using this superconductivity, and that is why we invest these scientists and these people working in the field, engineers, they invest their time, energy, and their all the intelligence into this to get some kind of these smart devices. Okay, so these are the applications of superconductivity. So now what we will do is quickly we will try to have a true false session of 5 questions only, and what you do is you just use chat box to say whether you think the statement made is true or false by just typing T or F into it. So let us say, let us quickly go with these 5 sentences. So electrical resistance of a substance in superconducting state becomes zero. So whether this is a true statement or false. So electrical resistance of a substance in superconducting state becomes zero. If you think in superconducting state electrical resistance becomes zero, then say true or T, or if you think it is false, then say F in the chat box. Okay, let us quickly go to the second question. That is, in superconducting state the material becomes paramagnetic. So do you think that in superconducting state the material becomes paramagnetic? So if you have listened the content correctly, all the carefully, the whatever is being discussed, so you will get all the answers very easily. So purposely I have used selected only very prominent facts to be discussed in this true false section. Okay. So just quickly you try to mark the second question's answer. So you can type as true, two false, or two true. So that way you can put it in the chat box. Okay. And the third is, for achieving superconductivity, a pair of electrons interact attractively in phonon field. These electrons are termed as Cooper pair electrons. So is it a correct statement that for achieving superconductivity, a pair of electrons interact attractively in phonon fields? These electrons are termed as Cooper pair electrons. So do we call them as Cooper pair electrons? Okay. And next is Meissner effect is related to optical behavior of superconductors. So is it a correct statement to say that Meissner effect is related to optical behavior of superconductors? So I will wait for a minute and you can mark your answer in the chat box. Okay, so the last is the temperature at which normal material turns into a superconductor is called as critical temperature. So the temperature at which normal material turns into a superconductor is called as critical temperature. Is it a correct statement to say that the temperature at which material turns into superconductor is called as critical temperature? Okay. So if everything has gone correct, so my code for this quiz is this is true, this is true, and this is also true. So what is wrong here is these substances are not paramagnetic, they are diamagnetic, and the Meissner effect is not related to optical behavior, rather it is related to magnetic behavior of the superconductors. So if you have got all these correct questions correct, so many congratulations to you. And in this 1 hour or so, we have made an attempt, sincere attempt to understand something about superconductivity. I hope this will create some curiosity in your mind about learning about physics, learning about superconductivity, and try to use them in the engineering and science field. So this session is open for the questions and queries. You can ask some doubts if you have it in the put them in the chat box. I will be happy to answer all the your queries. Okay, so